Clips, clips.
What are we? Dissidents, nearly. And I know that some of the guys who've come out of the military fairly recently, if they've started to pick up what we're all talking about, that is how the Ministry of Defence is labelling them. So if you come out of the military now and you dare to start questioning what it's all about, you're a dissident, and I think that's one step down from a domestic terrorist. So what we're saying is that we need to get the label back on the right people. And in my opinion, the domestic terrorists are in Westminster, and we need to actually keep pinning these little sound bites on these people. Yeah? Now, I did a bit of adjustment while I was listening. This is just to prove that we are all working together. This was a page in the UK column quite a while ago, but we did start to pick up on chemtrails. I think that was a picture taken, I think that's Plymouth. I can't read what it says now because it's too small. All I'll say is that from my military background, spent quite a lot of time at sea, particularly if you're near any of the aircraft carriers, especially the American ones, you see jets operating in a fantastic way. And when I saw the first aircraft going over my house where there was a trail from one horizon to another horizon, and I took the dogs for a walk, and when I came back 2 hours later, that trail was still there, I was amazed because it obviously was not a condensation trail. So for me, it's just obvious that these things are not normal. I can also tell you that recently we've had contact from an airline pilot. I won't say which airline he's involved with, but he phoned us up, said he'd been following what we were talking about and would like to meet us. And eventually when he did, he lives out of the country, but when he made one of the trips back to UK, he came down to Plymouth and came and had a chat with Mike and myself. And one of the things he was talking about was the trails. And he said, it's very obvious to me because I can be up at altitude watching them or seeing them or watching them being formed. But what he started to do was to put some facts about how it works in the aviation industry. And one of the things he's pointing out is that there are now standard additives in jet fuel. They're anti-static agents, so supposedly they are helping reduce the possibility of sort of spark ignited fire, particularly when they're refueling and things. And there is some background to this, but he gave us a couple of aviation fuel specification sheets where you can read about these additives, and clearly some of these additives are producing some of the trails, but he is also fully of the opinion that there are other aircraft out there that are spraying. But he says you daren't mention it within the company, and he said some of the pilots who've shown a bit of interest in what's going on were very quickly told, forget it, otherwise you won't be working with us much longer. So this pilot, who I think is going to give us more information, but he's talking about a fear culture within the airlines over people who know what's going on. The other thing I'll say is that it's also obvious to me, I'm just going to say from a professional point of view, that you see aircraft that are clearly on a commercial flight path. So that's one problem, but then you'll see these multiple aircraft, many of them at very low altitude, 8 or 10,000 feet. And they are clearly not commercial because they're not fuel efficient at those low altitudes. So my opinion is this is real and it's going on. You need to get to grips with it.
Are you saying they're actually creating chemtrails at 8 or 10,000 feet?
Absolutely, yeah.
Well, that's absolute proof that they are chemtrails
because they can't. Because they're too low for condensation trails. Yeah. If you want to get a bit technical, you have to do a bit of trigonometry. If you buy a cheap telescopic sight for an air rifle. And you can work it out on a piece of paper, but you take an assessment of the length of the aircraft, 110, 120 feet, and then you do a little bit of trigonometry. So you just need to be able to measure the angle that you're observing the aircraft, and you can calculate the height reasonably accurately. That's how they used to do it in the Second World War. I'm not that old. And this is the other thing that was mentioned, OSCE, and this is a document that I nearly fell off my perch when I found it on the internet, because all it says is common purpose. But this, if you just put in OSCE common purpose, you'll get it on Google. And if you read about it, they're talking about creating the security of the European Union from the Urals to the Atlantic. And they're talking about meetings to do with all sorts of semi-security type things throughout Europe, where very strange people are meeting to discuss it. So this thing is real, and there is absolutely a common purpose. But if you look at the way, it's just a brief comment on this, but if you look at the way we're now seeing geoengineering utilising airspace, the same thing is starting to go on with control of the oceans. So these big geoengineering projects require world government ultimately. So I just thought I'd put that up. Okay. Well, a little bit of blatant advertising in the UK column. I just want to say that for a long time we've been trying to do this business of pin on the perpetrators what needs to be pinned. They're traitors. It doesn't matter what party they're from, Gordon Brown as it was then, and a very young Cameron and Clegg. But these people are working together. They are working to a common purpose. Of course, a common purpose is actually a crime if you look it up in a law dictionary. And they're betraying the country. But we know that they're having their strings pulled. And I think it was the Mirror a few days ago actually just said, well, Cameron's a liar and he's a deceiver. And I liked that language. I was very impressed. And then it went on to say, but of course, he's only a front for the banksters. And I was fascinated by that because obviously that was a mainstream paper picking up on the type of language that's going around in the alternative press. Banker, gangster. So I think that we're having a much bigger effect than we think we are. And I won't betray too much, but Patrick said to me just now that he'd been in a particular bar up in London where there were people who we will call mainstream. I only wear a suit because it's a sort of uniform. I know that if I keep my suit on, some people believe me, some don't, but I'm winning more than I'm losing. But he said that he was amongst suits and they are now talking about reading our material and his material and other material. So it's good, isn't it? Right, now what I just wanted to do, and this is why I'm going to keep it quite loose, so I'm happy to drift around, but for me the biggest thing is this concept that we're being attacked, the subversion process. And this is the book that I first got this from. It was written by a guy called Christopher Story, who unfortunately is no longer with us. Many people are suspicious of his death. But whether it was suspicious or not, we don't know. But in the front of the book was a table. This is a similar table that I've got on screen. But essentially what it was talking about was the means by which society was going to be attacked. And so, for instance, it talked about in religion, false religions, spiritual desert, emptiness and ignorance, law and order, legislated, imposed, inconsistent, unwarranted bias in favour of the offender, victimisation of the victim. Now, what I've got on screen here is actually an early version. So the one I'm reading in the book is about 1985. This one here is from the 1970s, and it's very simplistic. I know there's a couple of spelling mistakes in it. But basically, it's a demoralisation plan, 15 to 20 years. These are the areas of society that were to be targeted. And this was the result. So education, permissive. Well, Margaret's been talking about sex education, and they are really going at the moment to mess the young children up. But you wanted people to come out of the education system who were ignorant. And why do you want that? Because, of course, if they're ignorant, they can be easily controlled. A culture, false heroes. Does Beckham come to mind? Just as an example. Sits in the box with the Queen, I think, at Wimbledon. False heroes and role models, addictive fads. And this is mass sports, actually. So I always find it now very creepy when I see these big, was it the Marathon of the Northeast or something? Or you see thousands of people all with their little pink ribbons or their little rubber armbands on. This is created. It's to get people thinking in a hive mentality. And of course, when you see it in a table like this, this starts to get you into the mindset of the people who are devious and evil enough to start to think about what they can do to mess us up. This is always a key one. Family, break them up. If you break up the family, the state claims the children. And that is absolutely what's going on. And I'm going to talk a bit about that a bit. Health, junk food. And what do you want? Enfeebled masses. People who are not fit. If you watch an old black and white film, doesn't matter how corny the film is, if you watch it, American film, British film, the thing that always sticks to me now is you see people who are slim. They're all slim, you know, they look basically healthy and slim. And that's not the case now. You're going to take people off the land, you're going to urbanize, and you're going to cause trouble, all right, victimization. But the first bit is demoralize. And you can see it, really, in people's faces. I'm going to watch your faces pretty carefully now. I won't look at anybody. But if you look at people on the streets, and when I was sort of driving along trying to find the pub this morning, you know, you look out the window and just people look downtrodden. They look unhappy and sad. And people have put this in as a plan. This is the next stage. Destabilization. So first of all, you get in and you demoralize people, and then when you've dragged them down so they haven't got much fighting capacity, then you're going to really get in amongst it. Yeah? Destruction of bargaining, grassroots, isolation, multi-nations. I can't remember what that is, but it'll come to me in a minute. But basically, you're locking nation states into these very complex partnerships and arrangements. So the country doesn't operate on its own. It can only operate with the French, or it can only operate with NATO, or it can only operate with the European Union. And I think that we are now into this stage. And this, remember, this was put together in the 1970s. Big Brother, that's what appeared. And by an amazing coincidence, we had Big Brother popped up on TV. And I'm told by psychiatrists and psychologists that a lot of Big Brother, particularly when you're, not that I watch it at all, but if you're sat there watching people sleep, you're actually destroying your mind. It's designed to destroy your mind. And it's heading towards this crisis. And this is where you're talking about revolution and the normalization. This doesn't mean that things go back to normal. If you put it in a communist, a Soviet or a corporate fascist sense, normalization is when the state is fully in control. So this book for me, which I've mentioned before, this was the book when I was reading it with a cup of tea one day and I thought, my God, this is happening. And maybe it was a bit easier for me because this is military psychological warfare the guy's talking about. The rest of the book's very complex political analysis about the Germans and the Soviet Union. And I'll just say, if you believe that the Berlin Wall came down, it absolutely didn't. It absolutely didn't. The only thing that formed our opinion on that is what we saw in the mass media. The wall physically fell, but the doctrine and the politics that was behind that wall not only stayed behind the wall, it then migrated across. And maybe I need to do a presentation talking about that. But it was one of the days other people had a real shock when 9/11 happened. I was just fascinated when the BBC told me one night, the Berlin Wall's come down, that's the end of communism. Well, the days leading up to it, I knew what I was looking at, which was all sorts of refurbishment of the Soviet military. And then after the wall's come down, I'm looking at the same stuff. And this wasn't, we were being fed junk, this was real. So somebody was lying, and of course it was the BBC. You won't be able to read this, but this is the 1985 version where there's a lot more detail. Media, monopolisation of news and comment, manipulation of information and thought, constant criticism and discrediting of institutions, concentration on fake non-issues, double standards. When you read this thing, it's absolutely creepy in how accurate it is to what's gone on. Social relations, a focus on rights, not obligations. Erosion of individual responsibility. Internal politics, aggressive, poisonous party antagonisms, a sense of drift, a failure to get to grips with issues, constant lying and equivocation. It's absolutely spot on for what we're seeing, and that's because what's happening around us has been planned. So what I thought I would do, I don't really need to say much there. Big Brother's still here. Big Brother appears in the wings in the EU context. Big Brother is the collective, the beast. Big Brother gains credibility, power. And what it ends up with is psychological collapse. That's what they've been trying to do with the European Union. This beast gets bigger and bigger, and eventually everybody says it's too late and it's taken us over. But luckily, it seems at the moment that there's real friction. So the project is not going as smoothly as they'd wanted. But behind the scenes, this was the level of thinking of people trying to manipulate us. And the guy who produced it was a Soviet defector called Yuri Bezmenov. And what was he seeing? Was he seeing this as the New World Order? Or was he seeing it part of CIA? Or was he seeing it part of some other plot? I don't know. But I just say that when you read it, it's very accurate on what we're seeing. So I thought we'd basically take a quick flick through the areas that he talked about. I noticed Patrick went black and white, so he had his text slides. I went the other way. You're going to get all colour. But I thought I'd just pick each one of these and just have a brief chat about it. And at the end, I just wanted to get a bit of free discussion going. This is religion. And the significance, does anybody know who this man is? Right, this is Nicky Gumbel. And this is the man that is the big man of the Alpha Course. And if you look at churches across the country, you'll see a man struggling with a question mark over his shoulder. And they're all running this man's course. It's based not on the Bible, it's based on his little green book. And he's given huge rallies with most of the European Commission there. And here he is with this man that many people think is a war criminal. And Tony Blair was his guest at the Royal Albert Hall in London when Alpha Course had a huge rally to celebrate how many churches they've penetrated. I think this man's a political agent. I don't think he's Christian. I think he's a Satanist. This man is definitely a Satanist. I don't know whether I'm going to upset anybody here, but this is part of the destabilisation of the country. I'll put it this way, that there's a backlash coming at the moment, a big backlash about people on benefits. Anybody who's taking benefit is a scrounger on society. The disabled are to be used as a weapon. So the country's been psyched up that everything's about disabled access and disabled this, disabled that. Now they're going to switch the switch and the backlash is coming. And the gays have been used. That's what I'm going to say. The gays have absolutely been used to be brought into the establishment, and particularly within the church, to help destabilise the church. If I offend anybody, I'm happy to discuss it afterwards. But these people are going to be sacrificed. Education, if you take any look at what's going on in schools at the moment, sex education is just being rammed in the faces of children, ever younger, five-year-old. And this is to get the children sexualized. And the reason they want them sexualized is because the plan is for the age of consent to be removed. And if you actually follow what Stonewall has been doing, they've steadily been pushing for the age of consent to be lowered. But behind the scenes, there was, well, it should be lowered to 5. But what I'm going to tell you is they want to get rid of the age of consent altogether, because in the new regime, paedophilia is to be, inverted commas, normal and acceptable. You can remind me of the 4 topics. I'll just keep going through the slides till we hit the next one. Culture, but soft porn, okay, is now everywhere. And of course, we know that the internet could be cleaned overnight by simply turning the filters on. But that's not going to happen, because you've got key people from Google and the web who are working with the government. So why do you want this stuff? You want it because it's a drug. It traps people, it draws them in. You get a fix at one level, and then you go looking for the next level. And of course, the other thing that's now happening is youngsters are being drawn into this. So if we look back to the start of the girly magazines, I won't look anybody in the eye here, but you go back to the late 50s, early 60s, and these things start appearing. And of course, there were people in the background funding it. And it was funded with a reason, because it was the start of the attack on people's minds. This is just a blurry clip, but even the Olympics got the treatment, because there were quite a few papers that were covering that, never mind the athletics, some of the images were quite sexy. And this was one, pole vaulting, isn't it? So this was put in one of the papers as an image which the boys might like. And when you follow it through, it's pretty easy to see who's there, who's in the smelly pile. And Tony Blair is one of my favourites, and he said here, Tony Blair has defended Labour's decision to take money from pornography publisher Richard Desmond, but admits he would love to stop having to raise party funds. So there's the diversionary argument, not is it right or wrong that you use soft porn to help fund the Labour Party. He detracts it by saying, well, we'd like to not run on donations at all. So I'm going to say to you, these people know absolutely what they're doing. There's no ifs or buts. You can just track it through. And well, here we are, Jimmy Savile. Now, I think we got to give credit to David Icke on this one, because David Icke was saying years ago that this man was very dangerous, and so was Bill Maloney from Pie and Mash Films. If you haven't watched any of Bill's films, the one to watch is Sun, Sea and Satan, where he's talking about what was going on in Jersey. I'm going to say to you, there's going to be a lot more coming out from Bill and other people who are now digging into this subject. But this man can't have done what he was doing without help from other people. So if you watch at the moment, there's a sense of drift coming into the press. It's all about Jimmy Savile. Well, Jimmy Savile couldn't take on the keys of Broadmoor without somebody agreeing that he was going to get those keys. So the issue is partly Jimmy Savile. He's dead. The real issue is, who was Jimmy Savile providing children for? And I'm going to say to you tonight, with some knowledge and people who have real knowledge, that this man is the centre of children being provided to all sorts of people, including politicians. So my prediction is you're going to see a massive attempt to blur the investigation over this guy. This lady is very interesting, Esther Ranson. She's been sort of caught in the, she's rabbit in the headlights, because at one stage she was saying, well, yes, this culture went on, and we were stopped from saying anything. So she's had all the publicity of running all the children's helplines, and this is the lady who stood up to protect children, but actually dig into her background, and she's another one that seems to have known what was going on and didn't do anything about it. And good old Harriet's been speaking out. She's been calling for an independent inquiry. And she says the BBC inquiries into revelations of child abuse by Jimmel Fix It presenter will not be robust enough. Well, that's pretty outspoken, isn't it? But of course, she's an absolute hypocrite, because this is the lady who was working with the National Council for Civil Liberties, and she was the one who was lobbying for it to be perfectly lawful for people to take pornographic pictures of children. And the onus should be on the parents of the children to prove that their children suffered as a result of the pornographic photography, not that the person taking the pictures should be targeted. So this woman has campaigned for paedophile action. And now all of a sudden she's saying, oh, we must have a more detailed investigation. I don't think she means that. I think she's one of the politicians that actually is desperately hoping this investigation is going to be shut down. And here's Jack Straw, accused of misleading MPs over the torture of Libyan dissidents. Welcome to Britain 2012, because we're involved in torture with the Americans. But this is also the man that amended the family court rules and rules to do with children, so that children in care were not allowed to speak out if they were being maltreated. Why would you introduce a law like that? I'll tell you, because you want to protect people who are abusing children. It's an unfortunate coincidence that his brother was actually accused of that. Here he is. 2009, the media will no longer be able to identify those involved in cases such as the Websters. That was a child case. It will also be illegal for any children currently in care to speak out, even if they feel they're being maltreated. Actually, so who's this lovely lady? Yeah, Janet Street Porter. And she's very interesting, because she's also been speaking out about Jimmy Savile. And I should have a little audio clip here. Let's see whether
Janet Street Porter, what do you make of the way the BBC's handled this?
Well, it's the classic way that they usually handle these things, which is to, instead of setting the agenda about how a story is broken and containing it, they react on a day-by-day basis. And when I was an executive there in 1988 and I worked alongside you, I think you'll agree with me, they haven't really learnt a lot in the intervening 24 years. Doesn't it show... Sorry to interrupt, Steve. I just want to say one thing, that Chris Patton and George Entwistle will say they want to slim down the top layers of the BBC. Well, here we've got a classic reason why they should, as soon as possible. And Mark Thompson said the same thing when he was DJ. Yeah. Because all these labyrinthine systems of reporting, here we have a scandal that can't be contained because the flow of information is so complex.
Well, except that. They say, actually, it isn't that complex.
Right, did you get what that woman said? Well, she is saying that the trouble with the BBC is they're a shambles because they haven't been able to control the agenda and contain the Jimmy Savile. She's not saying we need to get the lid off it and get the truth out. She's criticising the BBC because they haven't contained the story properly. Do you want to? Should we try and play it again? I'll probably just have to go. Okay, hold on. Hang on a minute. Oh, it's the glass. Can you mount the glass? Oh, yeah. Okay. That's it. Okay, that's good. All right, I'll try and play this again.
Janet, a street porter, what do you make of the way the BBC's handled this?
Well, it's the classic way that they usually handle these things, which is to, instead of setting the agenda about how a story is broken and containing it, they react on a day-by-day basis. And when I was an executive there in 1988 and I worked alongside you, I think you'll agree with me, they haven't really learnt a lot in the intervening 24 years. Doesn't it show... Sorry to interrupt, Steve. I just want to say one thing, that Chris Patton and George Entwistle say they want to slim down the top layers of the BBC. Well, here we've got a classic reason why they should as soon as possible. And Mark Thompson said the same thing when he was DJ. Mm. Because all these labyrinthine systems of reporting, here we have a scandal that can't be contained because the flow of information is so complex.
Well, except that they say actually it isn't that complex.
It should have been covered up better.
She was also saying that nothing has changed since
the These people know. Well, I'd give my opinion. My opinion is that the BBC has not only been riddled with this stuff, but basically the BBC has been helping to peddle the agenda which is taking us towards making paedophilia acceptable. Right? That's where I think the BBC's been going. So I might as well add at this point, I feel that now is the time for people to really focus on the BBC, and why should we pay our TV licences to an organisation that is promoting paedophilia?
Thank you. Especially
if it's in block capital letters.
Absolutely. Well, this is artwork in Ilfracombe in Devon, and it's Damien Hirst, who's had previous statues before. This is huge. It's about 40 foot high. So on one side, the woman has got all her skin on, but this side, she's flayed. So baby's in the womb, and you're seeing muscle and tissue. And that has been a... Pardon?
I'm sorry, what is that all about?
Right. If you read... I may be able to find it for you in the book. Hold on, I'll see if I can find it with my glasses. I'm not going to be able to see it that quickly. But if you look in this agenda for the attack on our minds, empty, unpleasant artwork... meaningless artwork, and this stuff is appearing all over the country. I've been on about it for some time, and I'm pleased to say I now get people sending me photographs and film clips of artwork that's gone up. This is designed to interfere with your mind. It is unpleasant, it's vicious, it must be incredibly scary for a young child, and it is designed to help people towards breakdowns.
Future of the way DNA is going. DNA manipulation, the way that they're messing around with our genes.
Well, it could have a message at that level, but I will say to you that Damien Hirst has done other ones where he's had...
not be put on public display. If you want to put it in a private art gallery, and people who've got very liberal ideas about
This is not only totally there in the harbour, but it's been approved by people locally, and it's been filmed being put in position by the BBC, and they're describing it as, oh, this is wonderful, whereas, of course, it's not. But this is the same mentality as things like the Angel of the North or the Wicker Man on the Somerset levels. So if we, at the end, I'm happy to sort of, let's get into things a bit deeper. But what is starting to overtake us isn't just a political ideology. This is stuff which you can call satanic, or you can say that it's very darkly spiritual.
Warrior, a useless, futile warrior that's pregnant and can't battle.
Maybe.
Can I intervene?
Yeah.
Have any of you heard of the 2040 program that's going on? Russia did a program back a year ago. They invited all the top scientists to come in, and they were discussing the next 40 years of the evolution of humanity. And what they're trying to do is mould humanity with machines.
Yeah, transhumanism.
I don't know if you've heard about this. It's gospel truth.
Yeah.
Go on YouTube, sort it out, 2040, put it in, 2040 programme.
Yeah.
They want to make us no more than humanoids.
Well, I'd just say that I have watched with interest as how we're seeing particularly the wounded coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan, very quickly being fitted up with high technology limbs. And I think there's more to it than just helping people with prosthetics. This is about the transhumanist agenda. But anyway, this one to me was particularly unpleasant, so I chose it. But if you look in the description of how we are to be attacked, it's a play on our minds. We replace beautiful, creative artwork with very dark and unpleasant stuff. This is also comes under sort of culture. I touched on this in South Wales when we were on the not very nice subject of suicide. This company that receives First Light receives national lottery funding, and they help children, filmed by over 11s. This is a documentary about a dog who commits suicide. It's a cartoon, and it's made by young children. And when I phoned the company, you just get this sort of very casual, blasé attitude. Well, what are you concerned about? But we've paid for that. Our money's been used for that. So we take another batch, law and order, social relations, security, internal politics, foreign relations. BBC actually reported this, but on the basis of London riots, there's a need that we have faster courts, so fast that you don't even have to appear in them. You can appear by video link, and you're in the court, dealt with, sentenced, and out. So these are the Stasi courts, and of course Ken Clark was the man who set this lot up, and then he's slipped out of the job. But they're using the trouble in London as an excuse that they need to have a system of mass courts. Of course, none of them will have juries. So this is very, very dangerous stuff. And of course, it's we've seen what Blair's been up to with Jack Straw, but now we've got the residue of Ken Clark. So you get in these courts, there is no jury. Just put up a photograph of the courts of misjustice, injustice, whatever it is. We could have a big discussion about that building. But if you've ever been to any cases up there, you just get a feeling that it's one big building of corruption. Here's the trouble on the London streets that we've seen. So just bear in mind what that table was talking about. It was starting to talk about breakdown and conflict, and now we've started to see that happen. And we've also got the police now acting unusually. So how many of you saw this? This was a blind man who they tasered because they thought he was carrying a samurai sword. So the police were initially, I believe, in a car. They didn't bother to go by him. They didn't bother to get in front of him or look. They simply tasered him and then jumped on his back and handcuffed him, with him saying, "I'm blind, I'm blind." The papers made a big deal out of it, you know, blind man tasered. But what I'm interested in is what was going through the minds of the police.
Excuse me, but a white stick really looks like a sword.
Well, absolutely, yeah. So we're talking to quite a lot of police these days. This is getting very interesting because they do talk to us and they're taking information, and they know that they've got colleagues who are not acting normally. And I think this is the result of the training that the police have been given, and they are not acting normally.
Do you mean mind control?
Yes, I do, yeah.
How much of the English police force is checked already? You know?
I don't know, but what I would say, if we come in positive, I do want to be positive by the end of this, but the police that are talking to us, if I go 2 years ago, they were very cautious in what they'd say. Now police are saying, we're watching colleagues, we've got colleagues who are not acting normally, we've got training courses coming up we don't like the look of, we're worried about this. And so I'm sidestepping your chipping question because I don't know. But I do believe we've now got police who are actually starting to say, hang on a minute, what's going on here? Yeah, yeah. But, you know, in my opinion, for supposedly trained people to taser somebody like that, they're not thinking properly. There's something else going on. Defence, well, something close to my heart. I know that lots of things I believed in the old days are not true. But if you just watch the national defence capability is being eroded and stripped away, and that's to lock us into these partnerships that this book was talking about. So Cameron hadn't even been elected, and the manoeuvring in the background was to lock us into a 50-year partnership with the French, very reliable allies over many hundreds of years. And of course, the is got rid of our aircraft carrier capability. Now, we know that something very interesting that happened is that after the decision was made to take the carrier out of service, they had teams on board within a matter, well, it was within two weeks, 10 days, who absolutely destroyed all of the computer systems and the main cabling. So if you wanted to make sure this ship was never going to be used again, no possibility of putting it in mothballs, the teams wrecked it electronically. And they did exactly the same with the maritime patrol aircraft, the Nimrods, up in Kinloss. In fact, they had the teams to destroy the simulators actually at the gate the morning the decision was made to scrap the aircraft. But the team were at the gate before the decision had been announced publicly. And they went in and destroyed all the simulators, which meant that there was no way the Nimrods could be saved. And then, of course, there had been a series of meetings before the strategic defence review with Cameron. This is going back to 2009. We printed in the column quite a lot of detail on this. There were meetings that took place facilitated by the charity, the Franco-British Council, and the meetings took place in the ambassador's residence in Paris, at which they decided what the British Strategic Defence Review was going to do. It was all decided behind closed doors before Cameron was even in power, and that was why he'd been in power a matter of weeks, and suddenly this 50-year partnership was announced. Well, when was the planning for that? Well, the planning was done behind closed doors. It was never discussed with the British public, and it was never discussed in Westminster. So the key bit is that the British military is being cut and cut and cut so that we are automatically dependent on the other countries. They knew they wouldn't get us into bed with the Germans. There's still too much feeling about Germany. So they've used the French as being a nation that we can sort of tolerate. But it's all about locking us into a one supranational military. Cameron, all he talks about really is war. You know, he's there boasting that they did Libya when he took other MPs around his residence. This was reported in the national papers. He stopped by a map and said, well, more or less, this is the world. We've done Libya. Where shall we invade next? And that was reported mainstream press. Is this man a psychopath? Well, he's got attributes. And war with Iran cannot be ruled out. So if you look at it with a common sense view, it does not make sense that this man would be saying we need to cut the military at the same time as he's talking about the risk of future conflicts. But if you know that what's going on here is to do with a world global agenda, meanwhile he wants to smash this country apart, it makes absolute sense. And what does it do? It brings back the bodies. And the statistic that's never properly come out is that for every body that comes back, there's between 4 and 6 seriously injured people. So, you know, at the moment, Afghanistan and Iraq is basically has been a sausage machine to create casualties. And I believe that they want some of those casualties because I believe they are using the wounded for experiments with prosthetics. This is, of course, when we're seeing the breakup of the country. So we don't have any debate in Westminster about what should happen with Scotland. Mr Cameron just goes north of the border and sits down, and it's all going to be organised. So this is the key thing. We don't see any real discussion now in Westminster. We've just got this president. And of course, Salmon's a liar because he's offering independence, but that Scotland can only ever be a region within Europe. So he's telling porky pies as well. But basically, if Scotland goes independent, we lose the base for the nuclear deterrent. And that was one of the key objects of the European Union, that Britain should be stripped of nuclear weapons. It's the French and the Germans are going to hold the nuclear weapons. This was the... I mentioned it early on about some of the words here. Banksters and speculators, Cameron smirk. He deceived voters to stumble into number 10 and will trick and lie to prolong a Downing Street occupation. So that was the Mirror actually said that. And I think that's pretty impressive that we've now got mainstream papers that are calling him a liar. Leveson inquiry. A lot of people have forgotten about it. We did a front page leading article on Leveson in the column, because we basically said the whole thing's a sham. So it was set up with the help of Common Purpose and the Media Standards Trust. They called for the inquiry. They set up the hacked off campaign. And then, of course, David Bell, who was chair of trustees with Common Purpose and also chairman of the Media Standards Trust, is selected by Leveson to run the panel. So what's going on here is the real start of the state close down of the media. But at the same time, Cameron simply withholds the emails he doesn't want the public to see. So we've already got the elite in position. And it's quite clear that the aim is to get fairly draconian controls over the mainstream media. Hence, as Patrick and the other speakers have said, we need to make sure that we keep the alternative media not only there, but growing as fast as possible. There's the happy couple. I think she got a payoff of $7 million, so she didn't disappear in a car crash. They've obviously decided to buy her off or buy her silence. And this man, of course, had to speak up. This is, do you know who this is? This is Chris Bryant, MP. Very interesting. He was a vicar at one stage. He worked for the BBC at one stage. He's Common Purpose through and through. But he was a victim of phone hacking. And he said that there's got to be, much more draconian investigation into what's going on. So this is the man that the media puts forward that we should pay attention to. And this is really how the UK column sees him. Because this was him advertising on a gay partner site. Sorry, chaps. But it's quite incredible that the press is prepared to put forward these people as people that we should listen to their opinions. Yeah, but not bad. Vicar, gay, Common Purpose. Okay, we're not going to get into a discussion on the Y fronts. And here's another one, of course, right? Poisonous party politics, a sense of drift, a failure to get to grips with issues. That's what the plan said. And so if you're going to do that, what are you going to do? You're going to bring into Westminster people who are basically bent. So this man, you know, fiddled his expenses with his living lover. Well, a lot of people said it was a criminal act. And now they've had attempts to block details of expenses, but one of the papers has actually blown the lid on it, that a Labour MP was renting out her property to another MP. So basically all the public money's just been circulated in a fraudulent loop. Why do you want bent, corrupt MPs?
So you can destroy the confidence in government.
Yeah, and you can control them. And the key method of control of these people is the children. Right? I keep stressing this. You can get away with fiddling. You can fiddling of expenses. You can get away with a bit of drugs. You can get away with rent boys, as that I can't think of his Oates, was it, the Lib Dem MP? Okay, what you can't get away with is paedophilia. And this is why the Jimmy Savile case is so important, because we're now starting to get near the fact. I'm not saying this man is a paedophile, let's just get it right, but what we are saying is that it is well known of the connections into the heart of government. And of course, the people who've got the films, the people who've got the pictures, are absolutely in control of these politicians. Am I confident about what I'm saying? Absolutely, because we have got police telling us what they know about what's been going on. Bill Maloney is also working with police who know what's going on. Yeah. Yes, I do. Yeah, and I think it's highly significant that Straw, when he first came into power as Home Secretary, one of the things he did is destroyed or started the initiative to destroying all the MI5 records of subversives in the country. So I believe that, just as we might say with the CIA, I think our British security services are rotten. I don't think they're rotten to the core. I think there are still good people involved. But like the police, we've got a bit of a battle going on as to which side is actually going to win. If you'd spoken to me 3 years ago, I was quite depressed because it seemed that the baddies were making most progress. But in the last 9 months, certainly the last 6 months, you just get a feeling that something's turned. I think there's a lot of police out there now who have had a belly full of watching criminals at high level, politicians, get away with it, and they're now saying we're going to stop it. And I think it's very significant that Andrew Mitchell, the guy on his bike who called the police plebs, he's lost his job. Now, how did that happen? Why did he lose his job? Well, no, I'm looking for a different answer. He lost his job because of the publicity. If you analyse what did the damage, it was the fact that the story came out publicly and then the truth just put the squeeze on him, and eventually it's got rid of him. And the reason I wanted to flag that up is because if we talk about what we can do to stop what's happening, it comes back to the truth and exposure. And also making sure that you know the person you're going for. So it wasn't an unknown person who'd sworn at the police. This was a known man. His face appeared in the papers. Bang. They have to get rid of him. So there's a lesson to be learnt for us.
Right. Yeah. I would suggest that perhaps people here would consider taking the UK, sending, not taking, because you're already on camera, UK columns. I've got two ready in big white envelopes to send to every police station in Bournemouth. And I'm also going to staple the Tony Farrell, Nick Collins from DVD onto one corner so it doesn't get lost in the envelope, so that every police station in Bournemouth gets one of those DVDs.
Okay, I think it's a brilliant idea. Let me come on to that at the end. I just want to whip through these slides, but I absolutely want to go where what you were talking about. Okay. So this is Dominic Strauss-Kahn, so one of the top men in the international monetary system. So he was accused of rape of a maid in a New York hotel. But in this amazing Guardian article, they're pointing out that he's been basically saying, well, men of a certain status, i.e. his sort of status, need to have these parties. And of course, he later went on to be exposed of having parties with prostitutes in France. But he's quite calmly saying, well, you know, this is the way we are. We sort of need these things. And he then goes on to boast that actually it's a bit Eyes Wide Shut. Now, how many of you have seen the film Eyes Wide Shut? If you haven't, you can watch it on... It's very explicit, but particularly if it's the European version. But you can see it on YouTube in clips. But basically, it's starring Tom Cruise here, but it's showing basically what is going on amongst the elite and the type of parties they're having. And it's a mixture between Satanism, well, it's Satanism with orgies. But it's very interesting that Mr. Khan feels cocky enough to say, well, this is the sort of thing we do. Yeah? He's confident. And I think this is one of the advantages that we're getting at the moment. The other side is getting too powerful, they're getting too cocky, and it's going to be their downfall. On the subject of cockiness, here's Charlie Boy. And, of course, we've got a man who says he should be Prince of Europe, Prince of Darkness, Dark Prince of Europe. And he's been writing and lobbying, but we're not allowed to know what he's talking about. And they've said that the Attorney General, Mr. Grieve, has said that they're not going to release 27 letters because it could damage the prince's ability to perform his duties as king. To which I say, well, if he's written a letter which is going to damage his performance as a king, we need to know about it. Yeah? Absolutely. But, of course, the thing's being covered up. So now we've... Pardon? What could he be saying? Well, I don't know. We could talk to his butler because he'd probably tell us what he's been up to. I'm not sure where this is going to go. Okay. Cameron, you know, who is running the country? We've picked up on this, bit of a sensitive subject. But David Cameron's on record as saying that his loyalty to Israel is unshakable. And I find this a fascinating comment, because if his loyalty to Israel is unshakable, where's his loyalty to this country? And I don't mind whether it was, you know, North Korea. He could be loyal to North Korea. The important thing is that he's telling us that his primary loyalty is not to this country. Yeah? And he's said this very clearly. Hang on a second, Mark. So basically, when you analyse it and you start to see British MPs of all three parties destroying the country, yeah, it does start to make complete sense. We think these people are British. I don't think Cameron's British. Well, I don't know what he is.
Cameron said, the day he got back from India, he actually said on the 6 o'clock news, and it was never shown again, and I think it was a missed thing that they put it on. He said, these were his exact words, the people will have to get used to the new world order. And then he said, I am proud to be able to trace my ancestry back to the Ashkenazis, the Zionists.
Yeah, well, I'm going to say I don't know, but I think it's a reasonable question. Is this man working for us, the British, in the broadest sense, or is he working for somebody else? I don't know.
He is the fourth cousin twice removed of the Queen of England. That's a genealogical record fact.
And that doesn't do him any favours, does it? So I just put another slide in. Here he is working away, you know, with Mr. Rumpy Bumpy. An EU referendum, well, it's not going to be an EU referendum by Christmas. He's talking about an EU referendum in the middle of the next parliament when the Tories are re-elected. So, again, everything is politics out of our hands. It's virtually the dictatorship. Sorry, so I'll go back. Family, health, race, population. Now, this is getting quite interesting. Other nations are now flagging up that their children are being taken away by Britain. And this was a story that broke over the Slovakian government speaking out very strongly, saying, why are British social services taking our children? Well, we come on to that. This was a demonstration in Rome, and this is the Italians saying, why is the British government taking our children? 1 in 100 patients to be put on a death list. Wow. How much, you know, I mean, how much more in your face could you get it? We're now heading towards the euthanasia program. We're not going to be looking after the frailest and weakest people in society. We're going to be putting people on death lists. And a man sent me an email and he says, I suppose it will be the death vans next. Yeah, pick them up from home and they never arrive at the other end. There was talk of it. This is, I keep my eyes very high here. This is in feeble masses and the diet. And I have to say that the times I've been to America, a couple of times I've been staggered at what I've seen. So clearly people are being attacked by their diet. There can't be any other reason for it. No, that's true. Well, whatever, but something's not right, is it? And here's the bit I was getting at with sort of disabled people. They're now starting to put across this image that if you're on benefits, you're a sucker. You're a leech on society. And I think you're going to see this becoming more and more aggressive. Parts of UK see young jobless figures soar by 1,700%. So in Spain at the moment, amongst young people, 50% unemployment. Not being mentioned really at all on BBC. But the problem's also starting in this country, and we've recently pointed out on UK Column Live that they're lying over the jobless figures in this country because part-time jobs are being counted as jobs. So if they say 500 jobs were created this month, of course many of those are part-time. They're not jobs which can sustain a family. So they're skewing the figures. So this is the economic collapse. This is basically celebrating diversity. Now, this is a difficult subject because we've all been so politically corrected that we don't like speaking about this sort of thing. But I talk to all sorts of audiences. We're told that we're celebrating the difference in cultures, but in actual fact, what's happening is we're all being used to attack each other. So we're not celebrating the differences. We're actually forcing people together. And this is absolutely deliberate because in the One World Order, of course, there's not going to be nation states. Forced vaccinations. And a key thing that's coming up on the 10th of November is a referendum in Ireland, but there's also a vote in the Irish Parliament where the law is going to be changed if it's a yes vote, so that the state effectively has priority control over children. And if this goes through, it's more or less one of the last big jigsaws to the fact that social services can take children at will, not only in this country, but internationally. Yeah. There's a very good website called Free Thinking Voice, which if you go on, has got a lot of information, not only about what's happening with children, but what's happening in Ireland. That's a gentleman called Kevin Bull and his wife, Katie. Okay, have I gone the wrong way? And we're getting to the end bit. Well, it's all been well covered by the earlier speakers, but all we see is an increase in debt, which is slavery. We're seeing the public sector being undermined because their jobs are being given away to the private sector. So we've got discontent there. We've got the wastelands across the country because there is no heavy industry or manufacturing. And this is obviously one of the Dockland areas. And the state is getting involved in everything. So the state regulates whatever you do, where you smoke, how much you can drink, and it can issue the fines at will. And where's Britain got to in the world? Because this thing talked about, the state of Britain in the world. And obviously we're now at the point where we're running food parcels in Britain. So we've been pulled right down. Sorry. The end bit, is the revolution. And this is what they would like, is the state. Now, I'm going to say I don't think they're going to achieve it, okay? But I've got a couple of bits here. This is not being shown on British TV. It's a film clip about trouble in Spain. And if you haven't seen any of this stuff, it's worth watching because the police are out of control. This is effectively happening all over Europe at the moment, but nothing appears on mainstream TV. Move on to this one. Right, horrible scenes. I think the government wants that sort of violence on British streets, and our primary job is to make sure it doesn't happen. This is absolutely critical. This is another scene of a crowd, but it's very interesting what happens, and I'm going to say this appears to be the right way to do it. Spain. Was it?
Might have been Italy. I don't know.
It should have been.
Because that's quite a juxtaposition between what we previously saw.
Yeah. Well, when the police were surrounded there, they must have been cacking themselves, because if the crowd had turned on them, they I think wouldn't be here. So it just shows you what power of people can be done can do, and what is necessary to. You know, to control things. So I'm watching the time. How is all this being done? Right, this man, some of you have heard me talking about him before, but if you never heard of him, Saul Alinsky is the man. Look at his material on the internet, download it, study it, because he put forward the plan for destroying us, which is this plan that's unfolding at the moment. Subversion, getting in amongst community groups and individuals and everything else. But if you read his way of doing things, we can absolutely do what he says back to the other side. And one of the things he says is personalise the issue. So we've got people at the moment not happy with the NHS. It's not worth anything talking about the NHS. You've got to go for the minister responsible. You've got to go for the head people in the NHS. Their pictures have got to appear, their names have got to appear, they have got to come to the forefront. It's very clever stuff when you read it. He's written it in a dark way, but you can pick off this stuff and say we can do the same thing. So Margaret, they're talking about sending the papers. Papers do get sent out to a whole host of people, including police and politicians and everything else. But we know that where people have picked up the phone to complain in numbers, so there's been some of the mums who've been picked up with the police in Merseyside, when the name will come to me in a minute, when she was arrested, and we tracked down where she was. We found where she was about midnight, and basically when the policeman took this lady in her cup of tea in the morning, he said, "Bloody hell, love, you've got a lot of friends." There had been so many phone calls that they'd shut down the call centre at 2 o'clock in the morning or 2:30, and that meant the chief constable was called out of his bed, right? So Maureen Spallack was the lady, sorry, Maureen. So basically, just people making a peaceful phone call. We had another mother called Elaine, north of the border in Scotland, has been assaulted and bullied and harassed, was getting very scared. We did an interview with her in the UK column Live, and we then put that interview up on the internet, and at the end of it put a film, a little clip saying, if you're not happy with what's happened to this lady, ring this man, the chief constable, right? And people did ring and did email, and that lady then said to us a couple of weeks ago that she had a visit by the police. My goodness, their attitude had completely changed, right? So have a look at this man and read what he was talking about, and then have a think about how we could use it.
What's
but
his name again, please?
Saul Alinsky. Yeah, okay. And the significance is he's a subversive, based on Marxism, but a subversive. His doctrine is within Tory and Labour policy. And I've already put up the documents to prove that. Yeah, so Cameron and Miliband and Clegg are using this man's tactics. That's why everybody's got this sense that things are falling apart, but you can't really see what it is because they've buried into everything.
Well,
and their father was an editor of a dictionary of Marxist thought, and he was one of the two guys that started Demos.
Right.
Yep, so the Miliband brothers in my book are Marxists.
Well, I mean, are they really Marxists at heart? I mean, you take on the mantle of
they're communitarian. They're communitarian.
When you get to that level, it doesn't matter. Just get in there.
Yeah. Well, communitarian is the best one because it's a sort of,
yeah,
it's a mixture of communism, fascism, and corporatism.
Yeah.
And it's not communism, you can see that. It's more fascist in the way they're using the big companies.
May I say, I agree with Alan Watt when he says at the local level it's going to be communist run by fascists at the top.
Yep.
Around the world.
Bad boys. I've shown this clip before, but it seems to be working well. This is a man called Dominic Campbell. He originally worked in local government, but he now says he's the work director at Future Gov, and the industry is government and military, and he's into change management. And this is his number two, Carrie Bishop. This is her website. I haven't fiddled around with it. She says she's a nosy parker, interested in social change and trainers. Okay? Now, what's the significance of these two? Listen to what this man talks about.
I'm going to do that very uncool TED thing of saying, this is really exciting for me to do this. You don't often hear that at the beginning of TED videos, but I think you should a bit more. So I'm going to talk to you about some of the work that we do. My name's Dominic Campbell. I run a small firm called FutureGov, and I'm lucky enough to work with a small gang of cool people who are really interested in how we can use technology in the web to transform government and politics. This is my personal story. This is where I started 9 years ago. Very, very classic local government story. That's Barnet Town Hall in North London. Doesn't look like the hotbed of innovation and disruption. So this is also me. The other side of my life is my web obsession, and in particular Twitter. And those two, the last two slides, are really the foundation of my career and the foundation of FutureGov, and also me being lucky enough to be part of this movement that's now often called Gov 2.0, Government 2.0, building on how do you transform the web government using Web 2.0 technologies. So Twitter has been pretty fundamental to why I'm here tonight in so many ways, which I can't really go into because there's so many of them, but it's fascinating just from a personal journey how disruptive to my life this disruptive technology has been, to actually take me out of being in the back office of a town hall in North London to suddenly being here 3 years later is phenomenal. What is the kind of culture that we're all striving for? What is the new world that we're pushing for? So I think that we're at a point now where you're either with us or you're against us. Are we actually going to transform government into something entirely different? I think the really crucial thing is that we're pushing from two sides. So on the one hand, we need to be disrupting from the inside of government. Disrupting from the inside of government. Disrupting from the inside of government. They're the ones who are creating parallel structures. Carrie Bishop, who I'm honoured to work with, who's a great colleague, she talks about parallel structures where you're not destroying the system with this technology, you're just creating an entirely new system. Just serve, using the web to create new structures for yourself. So normally where there's bright colours and shiny logos like these, you've normally stumbled into a place where social innovators are trying to do something new and creative and interesting. Yeah. And all I will say to finish is just to encourage you to join us now as a militant optimist. Get on the web, get creative, and get going. So thank you very much. Right.
That guy's a change agent. And he's telling you what they're doing, disrupting from the inside. And that's why nothing works. NHS, hospitals have trouble. They've got people like this in, deliberately disrupting and destabilising. Because if you've got a big organisation, particularly something as big as the NHS, and you want to change it, you want to privatise it, you've got to shake it so that nobody knows what's going on. And he's telling you, you're either with us or you're against us. He's talking about militant, he's talking about disrupting from the inside. And once you see these people, it's obvious what's going on. And we flagged up, of course, Julia Middleton, Chief Executive of Common Purpose, because her team are change agents. Yeah, the people who are Common Purpose trained, these are the change agents and disruptors. And of course, she's been organising inside deals with Francis Maud. Yeah? So, right, basically, David Bell, the man linked back to the Leveson inquiry, sat in a meeting where he was organising for his charity to train the top 200 civil servants. And when we've asked for the documents, this man, who boasts transparency, doesn't want to give them to us, because, of course, the moment you've got those documents, you can see exactly what disruption is going on. You won't see much of this, but that was a double-page spread in a copy of the column, which we're going to sort of blow up. But we're showing here's Cameron, here's Maud, here's Julia Middleton, Gus O'Donnell, as was head of the civil service. This is Jeff Mulgan of Demos. So that's a Marxist organisation. And these people working together with this man, Oliver Willier, a Frenchman, and he's an expert in behavioural change and manipulation. So they were holding meetings, and that's what we got a sniff of. So we asked for documents about the meetings these people were having, where they were discussing how to change the way we think and behave. Right? So the disruptors disrupt, and these people are working on how they play around with our minds. Keep calm and carry on, of course. And I'm just rushing on here. Right, we've got to get rid of these people. And that's what I wanted to focus on, because a lot of the talk is about what's there. It's all nasty. The economic system's collapsing. We've got the contrails there doing stuff with the water supply. What can we do? Well, I think the first thing we've got to do is concentrate on this country. Right? We can't help the Americans directly. The Americans are going to sort America out. We need to concentrate on this country. And we apply a bit of Agenda 21, which is what? What's the motto from Agenda 21? Think globally, act locally, right? So what we need to do is Saul Alinsky, but within our local communities. If you can explain to people in your hospital why they're having such a problem, then we start to take the hospital back. A lady came in to see me last week, said that she'd been sort of following what I've been doing for several years, quite a few actually, and I said to her, what do you think? And she said, well, as far as I'm concerned, Plymouth is now run by these people. And she said, I know where the money's gone. She'd worked for the Inland Revenue. She said, I know where the money's gone. I see what's going on in this city. It's being controlled by these people. But once you can see them, it's like woodworm, isn't it? Once you see the first little, oh my goodness, they're all over the place. So what we've got to do is personalise it. If you've got an area of government that's not going right, we need to be talking about the minister concerned, the NHS official. Yeah, personalise it.
Right, I know you're a bit short time, but can I say one quick thing?
Yeah.
I was given a message on YouTube recently, a private message, that skateboarders in Bournemouth are being employed by common purpose. One or two of them would be the older types, leaders, to sniff out anyone who's disagreeing with the government or...
This is absolutely right. It's not just common purpose. They're using all sorts of charity groups to do this.
Apparently they convince these young lads that they're better than the others and they're leaders.
Yeah.
They groom them to be leaders. When I handed them chemtrail leaflets, they were very interested. And then the 17-year-old, 18-year-old guy swung up on his skateboard and said, what are you preaching at us for, man? Go away. You
know? Yeah.
And it was very odd. And then I got this message and I realised, you know.
Well, if you get into this psychological manipulation, they are going for young people, they're going for through the schools. What we've got to do is keep pushing the message back the other way. And coming up here in the car, I got a call to say from somebody to say that there'd been a demonstration outside a Totnes school where the sixth form were demonstrating and handing out leaflets against the cervical cancer jab. I can't think what it's called now. Is anybody cool? Right, what did the school do? So the sixth form are handing out leaflets of the danger of that vaccine. They called the police. So the school called the police on their own students. So what we're going to do is be talking to a few people in Totnes to see whether we can get more leaflets out. But doesn't that tell you something wonderful that 17-year-olds are now. Well, there's that. Well, there's that as well. But this is where the good news is. Don't know whether you know about this one, but this was painted in a London street, and of course there's been big complaints about it as being anti-Semitic. The interesting thing is that it's pretty accurate, isn't it? We've discussed money supply. So we don't need to actually ask too many questions about bankers, but is this correct what's being shown? And of course, the second talk we had was on the money supply and the monopoly board, and here it is. Yeah, but people are waking up, so it's obvious. Okay, now, this was the latest UK column. I still can't tell you the name of this gentleman. I do know who he is. But this man stood up single-handedly to report what was going on in a school, Oxford and Cherwell Valley College. And he was reporting a confirming horrific physical and sexual abuse of students. They were white and the perpetrators were white. And what we've been told by students is this man was lost his job. He was then victimised and bullied and harassed. And all sorts of things have gone on around him. Now, we decided to put him on the front page because something interesting is happening in Oxford. The police have been arresting a lot of men as paedophiles, Asians, and they are not touching any of the people that the students are naming around this school. So they're picking up the Asian paedophiles, but they're not touching the white paedophiles. And here we've got an Asian gentleman is the Good Samaritan, because he stood up to defend the other children. And what happens? He gets victimised. Why? Because the government wants violence. And they are determined to get violence. Black and white, Christian, Muslim, Chinese, it doesn't matter what division they can create, they want the violence. So if you come back to that rioting on the streets, If they achieve the rioting on the streets, we lose. All right? If we can keep everything peaceful and you keep the knowledge flowing through, we win. And I am really encouraged by the police. I mean, I'm going to finish on the police, because the police are not only taking information from us, and we know other groups, but they give us a certain amount of information, and it's obvious that more of them are paying attention to what we're talking about. We need the police, because the police in their hands have got the power to clean up Parliament. And I know it's only a small thing with Andrew Mitchell, but the police took him on. They didn't back down over what he said to them, and ultimately he lost. And I think that's a really, you know, good thing for the police to have done. Are there bad guys out there? Absolutely. Off their heads. But the police have got to sort them out. Yeah?
Yeah. Britain is a corporation, and I just went to town half the lot. I had a proper talk to him. He listened to everything. He was really open to it. He even said about how he felt about how he was trying to push guns on them and how he would step down from his position if that was the case, because he would not morally be comfortable with taking guns on. You know, he was waking up, and he was really interested in everything he had to say, and he was going to email me for more information. So if you stop and talk to them, they listen and they're open, and if you genuinely approach them on a human, a compassionate level,
and this is so effective, because actually they're always trained to deal with hostility. Watch out for the person who's being aggressive to you, and if you're not aggressive to them, they don't know how to deal with it, and also you're talking to them as a human being. Right, good news. I think there is a phenomenal change at the moment. Patrick, I can just about see there under the light. I know you also feel it, and we've correct me if I'm wrong, other speakers, but basically, John and Patrick, you know, you're sensing the same thing. Ian Crane is sensing it. Ike is sensing it. Something is changing. Yeah. And we've got to keep pushing. And I'm going to say, I'm looking at all of you here, and what a brilliant event, okay? You've got to do something from here on. Now, I know some of you have travelled tonight, but if you're local, can I suggest you meet, say you're going to meet once a month, and just start to do your own thing, and it will grow. Yeah, but don't just walk away that it's been entertaining and you've picked up information. You need to do something. Yeah, I did a WI hall with 17 people as the first one. Ian Crane, I think, said he had 8 or something like that. And, you know, Patrick's got a similar story. You start, as you had on your slide, Patrick, ignore what other people say to you. They will tell you your slides are wrong, that your subject's wrong, your presentation's wrong. Just ignore them and do it, and then you find it starts to go. Yeah? But we've got to push. For me, if we don't push, never mind the chemtrails, the fluoride, everything else, they're going to have the children. Because they are very close now to stitching up this law, which means that the state owns the children.
They're teaching that to universities, that all babies born are state property.
Yeah.
My daughter confirmed that.
Right.
She studied sociology at Oxford. Well, they are state property, because when you stand, you're at university.
Well, I know, but we've got to make sure that this does not work. Yeah. Now, I believe that with regard to social services and child services at the moment, it's very easy that where the evidence exists that the snatch of the child, the stealing of the child is wrong, where the evidence exists, the names and hopefully the photographs of those people go up on the internet. Because the whole time they're anonymous, they're going to keep doing it. The moment their photos are up on the internet, they can't do it.
They're teaching them about desensitization.
Yes. Yeah. Well,
how about if you take emails from everyone that's local, and then we're able to keep in touch with the meeting, but they don't need to be able to sort it out, something like that. Maybe they made a list or something.
Yeah. Well, let's be clear that you're all welcome to come to Bournemouth, to our group. We meet every fortnight in a pub, in a small room in a pub, and we have a great meeting. And I've got people doing different things. Heather looks after drugs. nutrition.
build-up of arms there. We've got different people now starting to do to research different things for us, so it's really great.
Okay.
It's a very interesting evening, isn't it, folks?
Right. I'm just going to end on the note that if you ask me what this is about, it's a battle. The battle's between good and evil. It's spiritual. We could have another session on that, but it's absolutely spiritual. And so all the spiritual things apply. How you relate to other people, how you love other people. Praying is important if that is your thing. But it is absolutely spiritual. And it's becoming, for me, it's becoming more and more obvious it's spiritual. And I can tell you that this gentleman, I've had some amazing information via the students he's worked with. But that's a very spiritual gentleman as well. Okay. Right, I'm going to say thank you. It's late. I think you need a beer or something, or I need the beer. Jane, thank you very much. It's been brilliant.